Breaking news tonight, the Pope in America. A rousing welcome for the man who's been called the Rockstar Pope. Rockstar Pope Francis begins a historic visit.
The two leaders will speak to the world, then hold a one-on-one meeting with only translators in the room, all before Pope Francis addresses Congress Thursday with Biden in attendance. Even though the president and the Pope are allies on issues ranging from climate change to income inequality to Cuba, even the Iran nuclear deal, the White House refuses to reveal what the two men will discuss.
For the faithful who'd been waiting for hours, the emergence of Pope Francis shortly before 9 a.m. was the thrill of a lifetime. Thousands, led by the President and Mrs. Obama, waited to greet him. And after the official welcoming ceremony, both leaders addressed the significance of the visit.
And I believe the excitement around your visit, Holy Father, must be attributed not only to your role as Pope,
and I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. And he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness. And I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written: Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration.
We need to remember that we are followers of Jesus Christ. And his life, humanly speaking, ended in failure. The failure of the cross.
Moment. Pope Francis alone praying. He placed a rose atop the etched names of the 3,000 victims of the 9/11 attacks. His goal? Bringing people together. The pontiff chose this place to promote worldwide peace. The Pope joined hundreds of leaders of different faiths to talk about healing. Together, he led a prayer of peace for a violent world.
Peace in the hearts of all men and women, and peace among the nations.
He says he witnessed Pope Francis gracefully combining two contrasting passions in his effort to bring all religions together. The words may sound different, but the Pope gathered them into one voice for peace.
Papa Francesco, on behalf of this very distinguished group, representatives of the Hindu, Buddhist, Jain, Sikh, Native American, Jewish, Islamic, and Christian communities of New York City, our civic and public officials, and the board of the September 11th Memorial Foundation, I renew to you our welcome and our joy at your visit. Welcome, Holy Father.
We representatives of the world religions in this great city of New York gather to offer words of comfort and
intolerance prayer. And ignorance fueled those who attacked this place. The courage of today's gathering distinguishes us from the opponents of religious freedom as we stand together.
Namo Buddhaya Jayang Verang Pasavati Dukkhang Seti Parahati.
Homage to the Buddha. Victory begets enmity.
Not
the coat that we wear. That truth is above everything, and the highest deed is truthful living.
Μακάρι η πτωχή το πνεύματι, ότι αυτόν εστίν η βασιλεία των ουρανών.
For they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are the
There came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration.
It's awesome to have you around. I'm glad you're addicted to fighting tyranny. Great job. 30 seconds left. Anything else?
Yes, I would like to just end with this note. As far as all the things that have happened while the Pope has been visiting here, the thing that bothered me the most is when he said Christ failed on the cross. And I did a report earlier in the day. People can go look at it while I reference certain scriptures. But Christ didn't fail on the cross. He knew he was going to die on the cross. And he said, I'm giving myself willingly. So I was very disturbed to hear something like that.
He said that? I didn't know that. That was Christ's ultimate triumph.
Yeah. And he said he failed on the cross. As an ABC News, I'm sure it's a multiple.
Sounds like something the devil would say, Jakari. Thank you.
Per avere un rapporto personale, diretto, immediato con Gesù Cristo, al di fuori della comunione e della meditazione della Chiesa. Sono tentazioni pericolose.
I believe that God has brought me here to this year's Ministers' Conference in the spirit of Elijah. Let me explain. If you look carefully, the spirit of Elijah was on John the Baptist to turn the hearts of the sons to the fathers. And to turn the hearts of the fathers to the sons. To prepare the way for the Lord. And we know that prophecy always has a double fulfillment. And we know that Elijah will come before the second coming as well. And I've understood that the spirit of Elijah is the spirit of reconciliation, to return hearts to each other. This is very important. Catholic means if you're born again, raise your hand if you're born again. You're a Catholic. take back, redeem what belongs to you. We are Catholics. I've come to understand that diversity is divine. It's division that's diabolic. So that they may be one. It's the glory that glues us together, not the doctrines. It's the glory. If you accept that Christ is living in me and the presence of God is in me and the presence of God is in you, that's all we need. Because most of your fear is based on propaganda. Brothers and sisters, Luther's protest is over. Is yours. So the protest has been over for 15 years. And I get a bit cheeky here because I challenge my Protestant pastor friends. If there is no more protest, how can there be a Protestant church? Maybe we're all Catholics again. But we are reformed. We're Catholic in the universal sense. We are not protesting the doctrine of salvation by the Catholic Church anymore. We now preach the same gospel. We now preach you are saved by grace through faith. Alone, the word alone was the argument for 500 years. The word alone is there. You can read it yourself. The protest is over. The protest is over.
Thank you, sir. Come on, the man asked us to pray for him. Oh, Father. Father, we answer his request. And since we know not how to pray for him as we ought, other than to agree with him in his quest and in his heart for the unity of the body of Christ. We come together in the unity of our faith. Hallelujah.
The message we have, don't forget the silver cup of Benjamin was hidden in Benjamin's sack. You still remember that? In Benjamin's sack, the steward kept the silver cup. And why is it silver? Because silver is the metal for redemption. Gold is the metal for divinity. And notice it's empty. You know why it's empty? Because Jesus drank the cup of abomination, sin, and filth, and wickedness, and judgment. He drank it to his very last. Why is it empty? Because Jesus drank the cup of abomination, sin, and filth, and wickedness, and judgment. He drank it to his very last.
There are two qualifying statements about his death made in 1 Corinthians 15, at the beginning of the chapter. Paul says the first most important thing about our faith is that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. And those two qualifications will help you to understand God's point of view, why he wanted it to happen, why he let it happen to his son. If you want to understand the meaning of the cross, you must first of all see it according to the scriptures. And the key there is that the scriptures referred to are not your New Testament, which wasn't written when Paul said that. You are to go back to Jesus' Bible, and he only had the Old Testament scriptures. If you want to understand the cross, go to your Old Testament. That's quite a surprise to some people who think that the Old Testament isn't a Christian book and there's no point in Christians reading it. So when we're told he died according to the scriptures, that means according to the Old Testament. And you'll find the cross prefigured in every part of the Old Testament. And you'll begin to see why Jesus had to die and why God planned it. And why it just had to take. But he arranged the timing perfectly, and he arranged how he should die, on a cross. He'd always predicted that he'd be crucified, and so he had to arrange it. And he was in charge of his own death from beginning to end. That is the amazing thing. He decided where to die, when to die, and how to die. And the key is in the word cup. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when he prayed before the cross, he said, "Father, if it's possible, take this cup from me." Now, the word cup used in its literal sense is a drinking vessel. But in its metaphorical sense, it's always used of God's anger, his wrath. That's the association of God's cup. If it's not a literal cup, then it's the cup of God's anger.
Redemption. Gold is the metal for divinity. And notice it's empty. You know why it's empty? Because Jesus drank the cup of abomination, sin, and filth, and wickedness, and judgment. He drank it to his very last dregs. And today our message to the world is no more judgment.
Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and said to me, "Come, I will show you the judgment of the great whore who is seated on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and with the wine of whose fornication the inhabitants of the earth have become drunk." So he carried me away in the spirit into a wilderness. And I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast that was full of blasphemous names, and it had seven heads and ten horns. The woman was clothed in purple and scarlet, and adorned with gold and jewels and pearls, holding in her hand a golden cup full of abominations and the impurities of her fornication. And on her forehead was written a name, a mystery: Babylon the Great, mother of whores and of earth's abominations. And I saw that the woman was drunk with the blood of the saints and the blood of the witnesses to Jesus.
You know why it's empty? Because Jesus drank the cup of abomination, sin, and filth, and wickedness, and judgment. He drank it in his very last words. And today our message to the world is no more judgment, no more wrath from God, no more punishment. Jesus finished it.
President of Joseph Prince Ministries, Joseph and Wendy Prince, Grammy Award-winning worship leader, Israel Houghton. Now your host, Pastor Bill Munchie.
Give a warm welcome, Joseph and Wendy Prince. Would you? Wendy, we all wanted to see you because we never get to see you. And just real quickly, what happened and when did it happen to mandate upon your life to release this message?
Well, first, Phil, it's a joy to be here and to be with all of you. We finally get to meet our TV audience face to face. And it's one thing to have, you know, God gather the people together.
Yeah.
It's another thing to have the same spirit, the Benjamin generation, having the same mother. We have the same Heavenly Father and the same mother, Grace.
Amen.
And our mother is not law.
Grace is not a doctrine, it's not a subject. Grace is a person, Jesus Christ. Grace is not a doctrine, it's not a subject. Grace is a person, Jesus Christ.
And it's one thing to have, you know, God gather the people together.
Yeah.
It's another thing to have the same spirit, the Benjamin generation, having the same mother. We have the same Heavenly Father and the same mother, Grace.
Amen.
And our mother is not law. And it's one thing to have, you know, God gather the people together.
Yeah.
It's another thing to have the same spirit, the Benjamin generation, having the same mother. We have the same Heavenly Father and the same mother, Grace.
Amen.
And our mother is not law.
In
tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity?
I think everybody that loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
This is fantastic. I'm so thrilled to hear you say that. There's a wideness in God's mercy.
There is.
To a lost and a hurting world. Today I'm honored to have Bible teacher Beth Moore join me to talk about more of this and other things.
And not only that, but you know, I tell you, we don't have to agree with one another. We can say, I may not agree with everyone, but I would serve anyone. Mm-hmm. It's got to be that way for us, that we are a people, that we as servants of God, yeah. That if somebody said, well, would you serve over there? I can't believe you'd serve. Are you kidding me? Yeah. I would serve anywhere, and I would serve anybody, yeah. Even if they did not have anything close to the same right. Belief system. I want to love people, and I want to show the heart of Christ that comes in the kind of throwing your arms open, embracing of other people.
Exactly.
You know what? We don't want these kinds of barriers. This is the time on the kingdom calendar to come together. It is a must. It is the only way we can possibly rationalize the will of God for this hour where we sit.
How can we possibly say that we love one another if all we're going to do is find fault,
yes,
and differences, and be judgmental and critical and say things about people when we have absolutely no knowledge?
That's right.
Of what we're even talking about?
No. You know, I'm such a sanguine in my personality. I do love a party and a party mentality as well as anyone you'd ever meet. And I'll tell you one thing about unity and just about knowing one another across some of these former barriers and boundaries that we've had and all the segments of the body of Christ. It is just such a blast to get to know people.
Yeah,
I tell
right.
women all the time, because we've really, really fought to throw down some of those denominational barriers in the Bible studies. And one of the things that I've said to women time and again is that if you just knew each other, you'd love each other so
right.
much. It's
yeah.
so much fun. You, we have a mutual friend in Christine Kane.
Yeah.
And
he said, we've got to stop fighting. We may not all believe exactly the same, but we all serve the same God.
Now, I want to know, Bible, does the Bible teach that we should name a name? If they're in the wrong, should we name a name?
Oh, Rexella, we forget who wrote this book. God the Father, 2 Timothy 3:16. God the Holy Spirit, 2 Peter 1:21. Holy men of God spake and wrote as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. They did what they were told to do by God's Spirit. And when they named names, it was because God's Spirit led them to do so. This is a right thing. And over in Acts 13, verses 9 and 10, Elymas was trying to keep people from coming to Christ, and Paul looked at him filled with the Holy Spirit and said, you child of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness. Oh, Paul, that's not politically correct. No, but the Spirit told me to say it. Again, we get to 1 Timothy 1:20. And there is a man by the name of Hymenaeus and Alexander who've learned to blaspheme. And Paul has to rebuke them. Again, in 2 Timothy 2, verse 18, we again have that name, Hymenaeus, but this time his partner is Philetus. And they have erred, saying the resurrection has passed already and destroyed the faith of many. And he says, oh, Christ has come and we're not there. And he rebukes them for doing this dastardly deed. In 2 Timothy 4:10, Paul says, Demas hath forsaken us, having loved this present world. No, we're not going to take him back with us. He backslid. He turned from it. My answer is no. It's right to do when God says we're to do it. And as long, as I said earlier, anyone ever talks against my Christ or the cross of my Christ, or that he's not virgin born, that he's not God, he's not resurrected, like Bishop Spung, an Episcopalian. I did this not long ago on TBN. They didn't care. I'm going to speak up as long as I live.
That I see in the youth group, but I also see in the church at large, individual congregations. Because we have dumbed down the gospel, because we're not preaching the true gospel, and we are using carnal means to attract people. If you use carnal means to attract men, you're going to attract carnal men. And you're going to have to keep using greater carnal means to keep them in the church. So what has happened is this. We have these large churches filled with many unconverted carnal people. But in those churches, we also have this small group of people that honestly want Christ. And they honestly want His Word, and they honestly want to be transformed. They don't need anything else. All they need is true worship of the true God and Scripture being preached to them and lived out before them. That's what they want. Now, I want to tell you the great sin of the American pastor. And this has got me in a lot of trouble, but it's true. This small group of converted people in that local church, all they want is Jesus. And all they want to do is the right thing. They want purity. They want truth. They want Christ. But the pastor, in order to keep this larger group of unconverted people, he caters to them. So while he is feeding these carnal men and women with carnal things, he is letting the sheep of God starve to death. And he is going to stand before God one day in judgment. Listen, brother, if my wife was going grocery shopping, and when she was going out to her car, some men assailed her, attacked her brutally, and you walked by and you did not want to get involved because you didn't want to cause trouble, you didn't want to put yourself in harm's way, you just wanted everything to go smooth. After all that was done, I would look for those men to deal with them. But I want you to know this, I'd look for you too. Because you had a chance to stand for my wife, my bride. And out of self-preservation or wrong ideas, you did not do it. You're just as much responsible as those men who attacked her. And that's what's happening all throughout America with pastors. It's the bride of Christ. There are sheep in all these churches, many of them, even churches that seem somewhat heretical in places. You'll usually find a group of people who truly want Christ, but the leadership is catering to the carnal and letting the bride of Christ starve to death, impoverished. And that is wrong, and there's going to be judgment for it. And the same thing is happening to the youth. I know young people that say, you know, Brother Paul, I listen to you all the time. And I said, well, what about your church? He goes, well, they don't preach this. It's not what the other young people want. And so they give them what they want. I'm starving to death.
Let's open our heart to Him today.
It's the old mentality. So when you grapple with this notion of many paths to God, there has to be many paths to God because we are many people. And in the process, He reveals Himself in many ways.
And He has to reveal at your level, and not everybody's at the same level.
Not everybody's at the same level.
Not everybody's at the same
level. That's absolutely right.
Yeah.
That cross-pollinization that we talked about, that we are...
So we talk about that.
You know, that's the principle I teach, that find your passion in life and figure out a way to make money.
Well, he gets...
Because my Bible tells me that John saw in the book of Revelation a multitude no man could number, of every tongue, of every nation, of every tribe, which no man could number. But nothing is said of that in terms of those who go to hell. It seems like there are more going to heaven Whoa, hallelujah! And I think this church, this ministry has a lot to do with that.
The congregation at a Georgia megachurch heard a sermon they will never forget, and they heard it just one recent Sunday. Pastor Jim Swilly, a twice married father of four, stood before them, and a grandfather, as a matter of fact, and announced that he is gay.
There are two things in my life that are an absolute. I did not ask for either one of them. Both of them were imposed upon me. I had no control over either of them. One was the call of God on my life. The other thing, and I wouldn't have known what to call it at the time, was my sexual orientation. I know a lot of straight people think that orientation is a choice. I want to tell you that it certainly is not.
All right, well, Pastor.
Emma, these past 7 months have been incredible. And, I mean, honestly, when I saw you 7 months ago, I knew. I knew from that moment that I wanted to spend the rest of my life with you. You're kind, beautiful, smart. I can't picture a more perfect woman. So, Emma, Lily Thompson, will you marry me?
Yes, 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 yes. I have to see other guys on the side, but yes.
Wait, what? What are the guys? What are you talking about?
I'm the perfect woman. Just like you said, I'm going to have gourmet meals for us every single night. Our house is going to be perfect. Oh, it's going to be amazing, babe. And I mean, you don't really expect me to be a one-man and a woman anyway.
No, that's actually like a big part of marriage. Like, you and me, together.
Yeah, but I can't give up every guy. I mean, that's asking a little much, don't you think?
A little... I just asked you to marry me. If we're married, you can't see anyone else. That's
Babe, wait. It's okay. Listen to me. Look at me. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said that. You're right. I was wrong.
Thank you.
Totally understand where you're coming from. This is our moment. And we're going to be so happy together. Every single day. Except once a week.
Once a week? Okay.
Sibling once a week.
Did you not listen to anything
every other
I just
year?
Said? No.
On a leap year?
No. Okay, Emma, I can't.
Once a week on a leap year, and you're gonna freak out?
Emma, we're done.
What? Babe, you were just asking me to marry you. Are you kidding me? Seriously? Really?
All right, it was funny. It's meant to be funny. But can I ask an honest question? I don't want anybody being funny right now. Would you really marry somebody like that? never. Why? Because she may be a perfect wife. He may be a perfect cousin. Let's just talk about why. She may be the perfect wife, but she's still got those other guys in her heart, even if it is once a year. Now, you would never marry someone like that. What makes you think Jesus is coming back for a bride that's just the same? Give me just a little bit of the world. If you really believe that, you're as deceived as somebody that would marry a person like that. I'm going to show you the final words tonight that I want to show you, and that's the words of Jesus. He said it right out of his mouth. The person who has my commandments and keeps them is the one who really loves me. And I too will love him and will show, reveal, manifest myself to him. I will let myself be clearly seen by him and make myself real to him. Why do we want him to be real to us? Because you can never be changed unless you're beholding him, unless you're in his presence. Christianity without the presence of God is just religion. It may be relevant religion, but it's religion because you're not being changed. The only way you can change is to get into his presence. He's the one that changes us. And you can't get into his presence. And you can't get in to his presence if you're flirting with another lover, namely the world.
I love the message of grace. I love grace itself. Hey, 1971, when I was a heroin shooting, hippie, rock drumming rebel, God's grace came into my life and transformed me. And overnight, I went from being wicked to righteous in God's sight because of the grace of God, because of forgiveness, because of what Jesus did. And you know what grace is like? You ever been outside? It's hot. You're working hard. You work up a sweat and go inside, get a nice cold glass of water and grace just doesn't forgive. It transforms. It reinvigorates us. It refreshes us. I always welcome the message of grace, but there's a problem. There's a message today, a message of grace that's beautiful and wonderful, but it's mixed. It's got some error mixed in with it. I call it hyper grace, and that's why I wrote the book Hyper Grace, Exposing the Dangers of the Modern Grace Movement. You see, you add a little teaching like, well, the idea that when Jesus saved us, he forgave all of our future sins at that same moment. And, you know, the idea that the Holy Spirit doesn't convict us of sin because we're perfectly righteous in God's sight. And, you know, the idea that we don't have to confess our sins to God because we've already been forgiven all our sins. And after all, God doesn't forgive in installments. It doesn't take that much error. And then when you just mix it in a little bit, ew, I'm going to drink from that. I wrote the Hyper Grace book because I love the message of grace so much. And this book lays out the significant errors, some of which are getting very, very extreme, some of which even lead to universalism and the denial of future judgment at all, some of which say the words that Jesus spoke, the Sermon on the Mount, they're not for today. They were just for the Jews before the cross. There's some real danger in the hyper-grace movement. But when you read this book, you won't just find out what's wrong. You'll find out what true, beautiful, real grace is, and you'll be more indebted to God's grace and more transformed by God's grace than ever before.